instead of saying, yeah, we're going to kill your babies, haha, only joking. I said, yeah. No, we will kill your babies. And I thought the power of that and the strength of the lack of irony, the lack of glimpse in the eye was overwhelming in a great way. And it made me, yeah, to express it in a banal way, it made me really get this, like, okay, this is no joke. The most influential person in the definition of black metal was without a shadow of doubt Euronymous. Euronymous of Mayhem was the great ambassador for these philosophical thoughts. And he was very much a salesman in the way that he would strongly exaggerate to get his points come across. So, for example, a lot of things he said, you know, he didn't necessarily mean them literally, but he would put them very strongly so that, yeah, the message would come across. And he kept talking about, much like Edvard Munch, that it's not about being technical, it's about the feeling, it's about the atmosphere. So that's how you define black metal. And he said, as long as it's dark and it's got the feeling, it's black metal. And then I remember having this conversation with him and other people back then many times, but remember one of the conversations where it was just Euronymous and myself. I said, so how far would you go? And he said, even some Diamond Galas stuff is black metal. And I said, no, that's going too far. And he said, no, it is. And he said, and so is some Merciful Fate stuff. And he kept pushing. And he said that, listen, if it's got that feeling, that's what defines black metal. And it's not corpse paint, speed, or instrumentation. It's the feeling.
Hi, and welcome to Revolver's Fan First podcast. I'm your host, Christina Rowett, and joining me today is Satyr of Satyricon. Welcome.
Thank you so much.
Excellent. So we ask the same question every show, which is, who was the first artist you put on a pedestal?
I remember some of them. I had a journey where there wasn't a detour through pop music. I was a bit surprised by that sort of, you know, making friends, because I grew up a little bit here and there. I was born on the countryside, and then at the age of 10, I moved to a peninsula outside of Oslo. But before that, the social circle wasn't that big because I came from a really small place. So I had a couple of older cousins. There's a kid on one of the neighboring farms was a bit older than me, and these people they had a lot of impacts on my musical taste. And and this was I'm born in 1975, so this was the very beginning of the 80s. So I didn't go through a Michael Jackson phase or any of that. It was just Deep Purple, Zeppelin, and there was Black Sabbath, there was Kiss, there was Iron Maiden. It was also, I guess on the later stage, Ozzy Osbourne solo stuff.
Yep.
So all of this, Motorhead, yeah. So all of this, that became my bread and butter growing up. And from the hard rock of the 70s and the heavy metal of the early 80s, it went from, yeah, with the classic bands that I just mentioned, it went from there to thrash metal. And it was the same kind of thing where I moved from the countryside to this peninsula outside of Oslo. I remember I had just come there walking around with probably with one of my, you know, heavy metal outfits. And there's this kid that notices me, and we start talking, you know, just in the street outside our houses. And it turns out that his younger brother was in my class, and I hadn't even noticed his younger brother, but the older brother was a metal guy. And this was in the summer of 86. Yeah, so he started introducing me to heavier stuff. So from that point on, you know, it was all about like Slayer and Metallica and these bands. And I discovered, I don't know if I thought about that as black metal, but I discovered other bands a bit randomly myself, like Venom, Celtic Frost, Possessed, through just a bunch of coincidences. There were a few, very few radio shows, but like on small niche channels where there would be a metal show. And the way to go about things back then is that you would record the radio show onto a cassette. Yeah. And you'd sit and listen to it. And then there would be the odd song here and there, which was new to you. And that would be, you know, maybe one of your new favorite bands, I guess. Mm-hmm. And also I remember the most bizarre record store out on this peninsula in the basement of a residential house. And it had a bunch of LPs with the most extreme bands. Yeah, that's where I picked up you know, Venom records. That's where I picked up Possessed records and all of that. And a lot of that was just those purchases were based on like how the cover came across to me. And looking back, I always identify that as the turning point of like heading into more the extremities of metal music. Yeah.
Yeah. The left-hand path.
The left-hand path.
Yes. It took you. This is a random question. Did you ever find the really dark stuff? Do you ever find humor in it, in the absolute intensity of it? Or was it just darkness? I know that's an odd question, but
can't even remember what it was, but I saw something on television last night talking about the 90s being a time of irony, that was just talking about culture in general. And I thought to myself, okay, the 90s, I don't know where I was in the 90s, but I don't remember the 90s being all about irony. But certainly I remember the 2000s with you know, what is referred to as Scandi rock over here. So, you know, those would be the bands like, The Hives, Helicopters, Turbo Negro, and all of that stuff. And yeah, lots of great bands, but I always felt like, you know, all the irony, why so afraid? Because I always felt that the lack of humor, the lack of irony, and that the fact that, no, it's not a glimpse in the eye. And it, you know, it's almost like, I love the fact that someone was saying, instead of saying, yeah, we're going to kill your babies, haha, only joking. I said, yeah. No, we will kill your babies. And I thought the power of that and the strength of the lack of irony, the lack of glimpse in the eye was overwhelming in a great way. And it made me, yeah, to express it in a banal way, it made me really get this, like, okay, this is no joke, you know, this is serious. And I love that. So that's how I perceived it anyway.
I love that the answer was actually the complete flip, which is often an interesting one. Cause I mean, you like the malevolent stare it gave you on some level.
Yeah.
Like looked right back at, what was the first musical storyline you really got obsessed with?
What do you mean by that?
Like storyline of a song or a record or something that really was quite vivid to you, or one of the first when you were kind of first discovering this kind of music.
Well, again, it's all these faces, right? Just talking about records that were particularly important to me in general, Machine Head by Deep Purple, that played a big impact on my life. And I think Led Zeppelin 4 did well.
That whole 70s. The whole 70s.
Yeah. Slayer's Rain in Blood. I remember particularly with that record because that was one of those older kids down the street when I had moved to that peninsula outside of Oslo. He introduced me to that, and you know, I picked it up on LP, but I re-recorded it onto a cassette so that coming home from school, one of my duties to get my allowance was to walk the dog every single day. So just to head out and then walk the dog as soon as I came home. And that's how I got to the bottom musically of Rain and Blood. The cover was something that I studied in great detail, and to this day I hold it as one of the best album covers ever. But I think that the music had the same captivating effect on me as some music still has the capacity to expose me to, and that would be the thing where in the beginning stages you can't really figure out what's going on, but you just know it's great because there were too many layers for a kid who was 10, 11 years old to figure it out, like the speed, the rhythmical patterns, the pace of which Tom Araya was singing, the lyrics were too complicated for a 10, 11 year old having Norwegian as his mother tongue and all of that. But I was immensely drawn to this, but I spent a lot of time trying to figure it out. So it would be the most straightforward stuff that had the most impact on me. So you could say that, like the catchy middle section of Angel of Death, that wasn't that hard to figure out. Nor was the opening of Postmortem or the opening of the title track, things like that. But there were certainly a lot of other parts with their harmonies, the pace and everything that was, you know, a bit overwhelming. But even if I couldn't decode the whole thing, it's just like, okay, I'm not sure what's going on, but it's great. And then as time went by and more spins, bits and pieces fell into place. And it's interesting how once upon a time, Satyricon was signed to EMI, and the contract was with EMI Norway, but it was released via EMI in most European countries and with all their, you know, domestic offices, and that the head of EMI at the time when we signed here in Norway, he said that his way of getting to the bottom of because he was not just a corporate guy, he was a music guy, and he said that the way for him to figure out black metal and to actually start really liking it is that he started with the drums, trying to figure out what's going on with the drums, and then he would take the, like, take it instrument by instrument and put the bits and pieces together. But he said that it was only when he figured out that he had to take one instrument at a time, that's when he could figure it out, and not by taking it all in at the same time. And it was interesting to me how it was naive to the point where it's actually charming that I spoke to a member of the press quite recently that said that he was struggling to get to the bottom of the music that we had made for the Satyricon and Munch exhibition. And I said that, all right, well, it might take some time. So where are you at currently? And he said, well, you know, I had two or three spins. I had one at the subway, and I also had, I listened to some of it at the gym, and yeah, but I'm struggling. And I said, all right, well, first of all, I think there are many settings where you could enjoy this music. The gym doesn't strike me as one of them.
No.
No.
You should have an altar. You should have an altar. Let's do this properly. Let's have some lighting. It's a beautifully dark piece of music. It's beautiful darkness. And you excel at that. So well done. Anyway, he's having trouble.
Yeah, he's having trouble. And I think, like you pointed out, you have to set the stage. So, you know, whether it's an altar or whether it's, you know, being out there in nature, or just in the privacy of your own home with some dim lights and a certain volume and your willingness to give it all your attention. But also I have enjoyed this music in you know, the type of, like, for example, driving on countryside roads in the evening, just seeing the headlights of the car and just listening to the music, and while driving, no traffic, just being alone out there. And I enjoy that too. But it's interesting to see that the music that was written is, you know, for this art exhibition, that it takes on its own life outside the exhibition room. And I insist that the best possible way of enjoying the music, Satyricon and Munch, is inside that exhibition room. But we wouldn't have released it if it couldn't take on another shape or form or a life of its own. And I think in the same way with these paintings and the woodcut and the drawings and all of this Munch work that we have in this exhibition room, that obviously I have seen them in the vaults of the museum. Some of them I have seen in other exhibitions in the past, and if not those versions, other versions of the same motive and so on. And in the future, I will experience them in other constellations inside other exhibition rooms within the Munch Museum. And I'm sure that I will find new great ways of experiencing them. But for me, I don't see any greater way of enjoying these Munch works than in this order that we have placed them on the wall inside that particular room with that music. That is, for me, the best possible way of experiencing those Munch works. But that doesn't mean that, you know, that particular painting or that painting that has been around for the last 130 years is worthless without my music, you know.
Garbage. I won't ever buy it. This is not this is not silent art. What an outrage. Yeah. This is ridiculous.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Sorry?
How do you, like, that's kind of an interesting project to work on. Do you take in a lot? How much does what you take in visually play into music? I mean, and this was kind of a good time to do that.
Well, so Edvard Munch was a bit of a quote machine and very good at expressing the very core of his philosophy in a few sentences. He was a master at that game. And one of his most famous quotes was, "I do not paint what I see, but what I saw."
Okay.
That's
deep, man. So yeah, how you actually saw it in your head rather than what you actually, yeah. I think I'm understanding. I think I'm grasping.
So he grew up as an artist in the time of naturalism. So great emphasis on technique in the ideal world. A painting would have postcard-like qualities. It was just like picture perfect, and it would be a display of impressive technique and photographic qualities. And Munch felt that this whole thing was a bit vain and silly, and he wanted this to be about emotions. And he had another quote where he said that a lot of people think it's about technique. It's not about technique. A simple line can be great art if the line is performed with emotion.
Yep.
Yeah. So when working on this exhibition, when working on the music in particular, I thought, you know, how am I going to do this? And then I quickly realized that to try and make the music match with a certain painting or lithography, that's not going to work. Because if you think about it, just in simple terms, all it really takes is for someone to be inside that exhibition room and looking in the wrong direction, and then it doesn't work anymore, you know? So it became clear to me that the vast majority of the curating had to be done very early, so that I understood that it's going to have to be a case where we work on the curating in the early stages, and we're going to have to select something that, yeah, we like them one by one. We think they'll look good next to each other inside that room that we have plans for, but they all by themselves and together, they have to have something about them which I think that I can respond to musically. That's going to be crucial. Mm. And then throughout the composition and recording process, in my mind, I was always thinking that let the music be your emotional response to what all these paintings and lithographies have left inside of you. So my conclusion was basically that I do not write music to accompany what I see, but to what I saw, what they left inside of me. Yeah.
What you feel, what you feel, not what you feel, what you felt. No, it doesn't. Exactly. Maybe it translates. Maybe it translates.
No, but that's a good way of putting it. Yeah.
Well, it's interesting. Like just even going, because this is, I guess, about making things accessible, and what you're talking about, like to the someone, well, not accessible, but a richer experience. When you were, it's interesting when you're talking about like black metal and just the malevolent stare in it, not messing around and kind of looking you dead in the eye and having and being quite, it's not entry level music. It actually requires quite, and to get the feel, there is so much complexity. A lot of people, I think, can't necessarily unpack it to get to the emotion. And I think that's one of the problems. Well, not to say a problem, but it's not as easy. I don't know. And I wonder if people's ears were different in the 90s, or like how our ears have changed. I'm getting to a question. Can you tell us a bit about that moment and whether it was like the early, like Norwegian black metal? It's a fascinating thing, and you were actually in a part of it, and I've only kind of read things about it. What was this kind of moment like, and what did it smell like, and what did it, you know, what was this world that you inhabited at this moment? And that was a lot. That was a very long-winded question, but you like a long-winded answer, so I think we can vibe on this.
Yeah. So, so I grew up in what we refer to as the original Norwegian black metal scene. I am one of the persons that was a part of the both musical and social circle that set the stage for what is now it's been around for 30 years or so, I guess. Time flies, and I guess what's the most frustrating part to me is that there are a lot of people that have, you know, very opinionated about the definition of black metal, while at the same time not being there, because we were so few and it's such a long time ago that without mentioning names,
go on,
without mentioning names, there are so many bands out of this country that say, yeah, we started in so-and-so and built from there, and then we released. And I think to myself, no, you didn't. Because if you were there, as you claim in your press release, I would have known there's no way that there was a black metal band that, oh, they are... If they existed, we knew about them. No chance. And then even worse, now having people that are from a different country, from a different culture, and different age group, to try and like educate Satyricon on the definition of black metal. And I thought, oh no, God, why do I have to listen to someone do this to me? Because they have no idea. And the most influential person in the definition of black metal was without a shadow of doubt Euronymous. Euronymous of Mayhem was the great ambassador for these philosophical thoughts. And he was very much a salesman in the way that he would strongly exaggerate to get his points come across. So, for example, a lot of things he said you know, he didn't necessarily mean them literally, but he would put them very strongly so that, yeah, the message would come across. And he kept talking about, much like Edvard Munch, that it's not about technical, being technical. It's about the feeling. It's about the atmosphere. So that's how you define black metal. And he said, as long as it's dark and it's got the feeling, it's black metal. And then I remember having this conversation with him and other people back then many times. But remember one of the conversations where it was just Euronymous and myself. I said, so how far would you go? And he said, even some Diamond Galas stuff is black metal. And I said, no, that's going too far. And he said, no, it is. And he said, and so is some Merciful Fate stuff. And he kept pushing. And he said that, listen, if it's got that feeling, that's what defines black metal. And it's not corpse paint, speed, or instrumentation. It's the feeling. So obviously, I know that he was, you know, is communicating quite a few extreme examples, but that was in order. Yeah, that was in order for his points to become clear to people that this is really not about the BPM. It's not about corpse paint or no corpse paint. It's about that feeling. And then today, you see that there are bands out there who have. They have their spikes and their bullet belts. They have their corpse paint and they play fast and they have their leather jackets and this and that. And the instrumentation is there. So people say, all right, so it's black metal. And I say, well, is it really? Is it really black metal? I don't understand that. How can it be black metal? Because it sure sounds like what most people's idea about black metal is. But it has none of that feeling. And what was interesting when writing Satyricon and Munch was that I was working with an engineer that I have worked on and off with for a long time. And he's well familiar with black metal, but yeah, musically, he's got a way different background. And there were certain parts here where I felt like it was important for me to work on the sonics of the early days of Norwegian black metal, because I felt that I had parts which to me through and through, they were Norwegian black metal. And it was that feeling. And I felt that Edvard Munch, being one of the greatest artists of modern times, and obviously being Norwegian, and what Norwegian black metal has meant to Norwegian culture in general, that it would be a very powerful thing if we could take some of that sort of early 90s Norwegian black metal feeling and get it in here. So some of that, some of that is created through the sonics. Some of it is some of the specifics of how we perform our riffs, our parts. But also a lot of that can be created through the instrumentation and the tonality of what you do. And what is interesting is what we ended up with. I think that, as you're saying, there are a lot of layers here to dig into and might not be the easiest thing in the world, but if you look at it, the instrumentation is cello, viola, woodwinds, a bunch of analog synthesizers, percussion, guitars, bass, baritone guitars, grand piano, this and that. And with very few exceptions, all of this has been utilized by Satyricon in the past. But what we have done is that we have reversed the roles of the instrumentation. So where you're saying in a typical Satyricon song, there's going to be drums all over it. Here, there's only percussion and some drums here and there.
And some human noises.
Yeah.
And most very human noises.
Human noises. Most of our songs will have vocals. This musical work has no vocals, hence it being a musical work. But
it's that boom, like that. There's little things that feel kind of human, not voice. That sounds weird, but you get.
So that would be, I know what you're referring to. Yeah. That would be both old analog synthesizers, theremin, and the bass clarinet creating some of them.
Theremin is the best fun instrument ever. I can play theremin. That's the funnest theremin, instrument to play ever. So much fun. Anyway, carry on.
And if you do think that the theremin is the greatest instrument ever, I should tell you that I was lucky enough to get one of those Moog Clarivox Centennial Edition theremins, which comes with a built-in analog delay, and that it is great for a theremin to have a built-in analog delay, because the textural layers that you can create with the theremin, that's what's interesting to me about the theremin. But it is very difficult if you want to play around with an analog delay in the aftermath of the recording, because that means that you cannot respond to what the delay is doing in real time. Mm-hmm. But when you have that built-in delay, you can work on creating your textural sounds, but you will feel what that analog delay is doing in real time, and your next move, you can respond to that as you go, and instead of sitting there doing it with the buttons in the aftermath.
It's fun. Like it's something that spontaneity in the moment, and to create like the whole concept of feel and stuff. And what you're saying about black metal is like, it's not what you see, it's what you feel. We're all looping it all back together. And I think it's kind of like, from what you're saying, it's like blackened soul music. It's soul music. It's just blackened. It's just a blackened soul. And I have to ask, going back to like this tiny group of people and this manifesto and stuff, what, for people who maybe aren't as familiar, what were some of the most extreme ideas that were put across, and what do you think the underlying, like, I guess, message and manifesto was of this kind of movement you've been part of creating?
Well, so a lot of what was being talked about back then was how many of the American bands would, for example, a lot of the death metal bands, they would sing about quite extreme things, but they would make it a point to let everyone know that it's just a, you know, just making fun, it's just a joke.
And, totally. Yeah. Cannibal Corpse. So actually, I don't know
what that is. But also, I like the music of Carcass, and I like the guys in Carcass, but I even at the time felt that it was somewhat disappointing that they would say that, we don't really know, we were just being sort of looking up in medical books and, you know, all this crazy shit. So they're kind of saying, like, to me as a fan, that what you take seriously, don't take it seriously, because we don't. that is very, you know, disillusional in a way. You become disappointed. And one of the things that that Norwegian black metal tried to do was the opposite of that. So that, what we try and tell you here is indeed what we feel and what we stand for. And you don't have to be afraid of reading an interview where we say, oh, no, I saw it, you know, don't take it seriously. Please take it seriously. And also, I remember, from the visual point of view, that it was important that there was going to be some correlation between the atmosphere of the music and the visual identity of a band. And that was also a response to what was going on out there, where you kind of felt that some of these death metal bands, where you're getting to the stage where you felt that when they were literally taking the stage on one of their shows, you weren't quite sure if is that the lead guitar player or would that be the guitar tech, you know, like who's that guy? And we were saying that, all right, if we are artists, you know, let's look like artists. And this whole thing about metal making an effort to kill the entire larger than life thing that metal was very much about was very disappointing to us. So we tried to do the opposite.
Who did you want to emulate visually? Who were you like? And what was the most ridiculous phase in your, like, where you just went incredibly hard? Especially, I mean, you're 16, you joined Satyricon. I mean, I'm just kind of throwing things into the air and seeing what catches.
I think in our case, it wasn't so much about, I mean, you know, obviously I was 15 when I started doing this. Yeah. And I think that there are always going to be things that we have said and done when looking back that they're like, okay, you see that is a work of a teenager and
it's awesome.
And not an adult. But then on the other hand, I think that I don't really, you know, looking back, there are a lot of things that could have been better musically, visually, this and that. But I don't feel like everything we did was honest, right? So for me, we were very much inspired by nature, by night, by mythology. And I think that's what we tried to come across with visually as well. And I guess we saw ourselves as warriors of some sort, and that's what we tried to come across with. And then some people, you know, fall in love with that and they want to see that forever and ever, but that would be dishonest because you have to represent yourself and as an artist where you are at any given time. And you know, the exhibition Satyricon and Munch, the musical work Satyricon and Munch in album format and everything that goes with it is a representation of where Satyricon are today as artists. And anything else would be dishonest.
Yeah. Well, it's important. It's important to be honest. And like, I enjoy the different places you've gone and there's as a child of 70s rock, like you can hear that Sabbathian influence in with that black metal kind of thing. And I really love that because I feel like there's this beautiful coldness and warmth to those two styles of music and that speed and like the power and the depth. It's very interesting. And it definitely, from you telling your story, you can definitely see where that's coming from. And that's, you know, I think that balance is interesting. Did your heart start beating slower? Is this what happened? Your heart was beating quite fast as a kid and Frost and, you know, like, and now your heart is slowed. I'm being ridiculous, but.
Yeah, no, I'm listening. A lot of people asked when heading into this, or actually perhaps even more so as we were getting closer to opening day of the exhibition, whether I felt nervous. And I said that no, there's nothing to be nervous about because we are doing what we want to do. We have given everything that we can. And what I always do when I am not exactly sure what the answer is and what the solution is, I work harder. I once had a physical trainer trying to show me an exercise which was really, really a defining moment in my life. And I was trying to do this exercise And I thought to myself, it is ridiculous. How can he expect me to do this? There's just no way. And I looked at him and I said, come on, man, what am I supposed to do here? And said, no, you're going to have to try harder. And I said, yeah, but I am, but there's just no way. And so tell me, is it technique? Or he said, no, you're going to have to try harder. And I said, what is that supposed to mean? What do you mean try harder? And he's like, well, that's it. You have to try harder. You have to dig deeper. That's it. And it's very offensive to me and made me really mad. And so I had another go and I thought, fuck this guy. And then I gave it everything and I made it. And I was very surprised. And I thought, oh, what happened? And I said, yeah. So it actually worked. And I said, yeah. And he made it so simple. So that was a lesson to me that there is always the option to dig deeper. And I know that a friend of mine in professional sports, he said that I'm not worried about the youth. The only thing that we have to work on, particularly with young athletes, is to make them understand the pain of going deep down in the basement and how that feels on your body, and to accept that state of pain that yep. you're going to feel and to be able to live with it. And there is a musical version of this too, and much of that I experienced with Satyricon and Munch, that you know, I know what I want to do, but I don't have any friends or colleagues that have done this before, so I don't know, I don't have anyone to call for advice, and I'm sitting there kind of struggling. And then I think to myself, okay, so what am I going to do? Well, I'm just going to have to, instead of working from 10 o'clock to 7 o'clock, Monday through Friday, I'm going to have to keep working as I get home from the studio, and I'm going to have to work Saturdays and Sundays as well. And eventually I will figure it out, but I have to dig deeper. I have to try harder. And also another thing that I tried applying when I couldn't exactly figure out what to do was that I kept telling myself that just do as you always do. Do it with honesty, integrity, unfiltered, and that will stand above any criticism. You can always say that it's not for me. My taste is like this and that, but no one can criticize something that has been done with unfalsified, you know, honesty and integrity. Yes. So that was my mindset when working with Satyricon and Munch, regardless of my heart rate. Yeah.
Yes. Thank you for taking that on board and going with it. There's some really great books on this topic. There's a guy, a Navy SEAL called David Goggins, who wrote a great book about embracing suffering and how one of the biggest problems in human society is we just seek, so many people just seek comfort when that's not actually how you're going to grow. And that's kind of stymies human development, which is an interesting thing. But to go deeper, I was looking at your five most played songs on Spotify, just which is an interesting cross-section of your work. And I was wondering if we could talk about some like a secret about each of them or something you haven't spoken about regarding the song. Guess what number one is?
Well, I'm looking at my
Yeah, you got some good numbers there. It's people who embrace your work. You've got a quite a solid. You know, it's beautiful to build something and have this.
I'm just looking at my I'm looking at my Spotify account on my iPhone here to try and.
It is. I wasn't actually asking you to look it up. I have it written down. I was just wondering if you had a guess. I've got the list. You don't need to. That would be very lazy journalism. Please work it out. No, King.
King?
Yeah.
That's the number one?
Yep.
Yeah. Last time I saw numbers like that, I find them confusing because I would always expect King and Mother North to be very high up there.
They are.
So these two, Black Crow on a Tombstone, Phoenix perhaps.
You're bang on, yes. Yes, yeah. And the Pentagram Burns.
And then the Pentagram Burns. Yep. It is interesting with... the Age of Nero record, because in terms of streams and physical format, I think altogether it is, if you look at it just commercially speaking, it is the most popular Satyricon record ever. But strangely enough, there are other records that seemingly people talk more about, but the Age of Nero is undeniably the altogether, when looking at physical copies and streams, the most popular Satyricon record of all time.
Well, what about a secret about the making of that? I mean, I suppose you tell your secrets, you know, this is the premise of...
Well, I think a good story from the making of that record is that what came on a lot of people's radar was this documentary involving Dave Grohl about Sound City, the studio, and this legendary Neve console I think Dave Grohl owns that console today, to my knowledge. That's where this studio and that console is where most of that record was done.
Yeah, cool.
And a lot of people, I was telling people about, you know, this fantastic studio where all of these iconic albums were recorded. And yeah, whenever I told people back then, it was just like, oh, all right, or whatever. And then the same friends of mine, they saw this documentary and talking about Sound City and this Neve console and Dave Grohl. And I said, yeah, as I told you before, that's where we did most of the Age of Nero. Oh, did you? Yes.
And that was a
fantastic studio. It's something, you know, for me to be in that studio, knowing which records had been done there. And it was awe-inspiring to go to work every day and in this incredible environment. And then I also know that because it was largely unchanged from its heydays, I was told that it was the set of many a Hollywood movie where they wanted to have something look authentic 60s, authentic 70s. And they would use the main recording room to set the stage for whatever scene they were shooting, because it basically had architecture and materials that where time had stood still. So
cool.
Yeah,
it's good to have time stand still. It was a golden. There was a lot of great music being made. You were born at a very good time, especially you weren't born at a very good time, really, in terms of the trajectory of rock music when you get right down to it.
I think about, you know,
that time. Yeah.
I think about my mother born in 1946 and my father born in 1950. And I think, wow, these people, they were there when the Beatles were there, and that's just true.
It's wild. Like, it's, and I guess we all get our okay. What do you think is the moment for you that you got to witness?
Oh, that's a great question. Well, I'm glad that I got to see Iron Maiden in the 80s. I'm glad I got to see Metallica, Slayer, Anthrax, Testament, Candlemass, all these bands in the 80s. I thought that I wouldn't say that I consider it an underestimated record, but maybe a record that has gone under the radar to a lot of extreme metal fans was the Atheist debut album called Piece of Time, and with this incredible punk rocker type of bass player. I think his name was Ronnie Patterson, if I'm not mistaken. And it was great to be able to see them when the album was brand new. And bizarrely enough, they opened for the Swedish doom metal band Candlemass.
Nice.
I saw Slayer tour with Rain in Blood. I saw Anthrax and Testament together when Anthrax had just released Among the Living. So Maiden with Somewhere in Time, Metallica with Master of Puppets and Justice for All. I saw King Diamond with on the Conspiracy tour, and a lot of things like that. That was, if not my moment in time, was certainly a fantastic thing to be able to experience these things that we today consider as classics, when they were brand new.
Yes.
That's important. There's a lot. It's not really about it's not really about bragging rights. It's just about having that historical perspective. And I think that that's something that that I miss today than when I am, you know, I'm so invested in my love for wine and wine culture. And I even run my own wine production company, and I have a lot of friends with incredible wine cellars, and some of them quite a bit older than me. And then we taste some bottles from producers and vineyards that I'm well familiar with. But, you know, I just wasn't into wine in the early 90s, but they were. So when we taste these bottles in a mature state, and they are so incredibly fascinating, with so many layers and with profound complexity, and I hear these guys talking about how this bottle tasted when it was released on the market, and the story of how they followed it through all its stages of maturation. And then I think, well, I'm having a great time enjoying it as it is now. But yeah, I would have loved to have their perspective, you know?
Totally. And that's a really good analogy, really, for music. I like how loud your Beatles moments were. They're all very loud. These are very loud moments in time. And I have to ask you, so we had Scott Ian on the show last week, and we're talking about the moment that thrash broke through and became a thing. And he said it was when Ozzy Osbourne did an arena tour and had Metallica open for them. The consensus in the comments was Metallica basically blew them completely off the stage, and that was why that was this moment that thrash became a thing. When do you think Norwegian black metal became a thing? Was there a catalyst moment, or was it kind of a slow burn, or that you felt like you were really reaching out into the world and it was kind of taking hold?
I'm not trying to be funny, but all I could think of when you're asking the question is when my oldest son, I had Scott Ian for lunch and he kept taking Scott's napkin all the time. That's all he would do. That's my Scotty memory.
It's a random thing. It's fine.
Yeah.
You don't have to have a moment. I was just wondering. It was very specific. Okay. Yeah. What's the most ridiculous argument you've ever had with a bandmate?
Too many, huh?
I feel like you've had some.
So, Frost and I, we've never had any serious arguments. This is more a question of the discussions that I've had with all these live musicians that we've had throughout the years. And when they have gotten really silly, it's this thing where they have certain ideas about how, Satyricon should be run. And then I always tried to make it a point to listen to them and say that, all right, let's hear it. And then also to give them the respectful answer that they deserve, right?
Yep.
But too often, they're not really interested in my perspective or having a discussion. Is that basically what I realized, that what they want to do is that tell me that I'm wrong, and then I'm supposed to say, oh, I see, I'm wrong, and then I have to agree with that, so that's basically what they're looking to get. These arguments, they turn out really silly. Usually the way they end is as all right, so seemingly you don't like the way we run the ship, so I've got an idea for you. Why don't you go out and have your own Satyricon, and then you just run that Satyricon the way that you want. And then obviously what always happens is like, oh, no, come on, man. I don't mean it like that. So, okay, so what do you mean then? So it's just any arguments is typically it's always about someone thinks that they know how to do this a lot better. There's only one problem. They don't want to do it themselves. They want you to do it, but you should be doing it the way they think it should be done, although they don't actually have any experience in running a band. So yeah, and these arguments are futile, meaningless, no sense. So
well, you've got a good musical marriage with Frost. That's a long-term marriage.
It's an interesting relationship because it's one of mutual respect. In a way, over time, I found that we are more similar than we are different from each other. And I think that in the beginning, I felt more strongly that we are really, really different as people, but we both serve Satyricon as an institution that we both find to be more important than our sort of personal interests and priorities. So, I used soccer comparison, saying that it's not about the player, it's about the club. And Satyricon is very much like that. It's not about the players, it's about the club. And we always had that in common. But I find that, as we've grown older, I think that Frost and I, we aren't that different. But I think we've come across very differently. But he's philosophical. He's got long answers, and
I like a long answer. Yeah. I mean, I haven't used a lot of this at all, but it's, no. I mean, I don't mind. It's fun. I like a complex idea. It's good to get into the guts of things, and you're obviously a thinker. You ponder things. It's good to ponder. Okay, I've got a little rapid fire question for you. I know we're, do you mind if we go, if we've gone over time? Probably. Do you need
no to- that's okay. I have two morning interviews and yours is the second one, so we're good. Yeah, absolutely. Okay, sweet.
Who would be on your musical Mount Rushmore if you had four faces carved into stone? Which is an American reference.
Jim Morrison?
Yeah. Yeah?
Wait.
You have to tell me why. You're not just burning through this. Yeah. Why Jim Morrison?
The voice. And the poet. And the charisma and the good looks and this otherworldliness, you know, he's the full package, you know.
Did you ever sing The Doors to yourself at home?
So I've been listening to The Doors as one of the non-metal bands that I always liked. I had a friend of my parents who was an absolute music maniac and with a huge vinyl collection. He introduced me to things that I asked him to introduce me to, things that were on the sidetrack of metal that could be interesting to me. So yeah, it was The Doors, Frank Zappa, Sid Barrett, but what really became close to my heart was the music of The Doors. Jim would have to be there. I think that I rarely find, you know, greater musical pleasure than when listening to John Bonham play drums.
Yeah.
I think that if I was a drummer, I would probably feel like I should just quit. You know, because
I was listening to When the Levee Breaks the other, like earlier in today, and it's quite a song.
So when he's playing, he was creative in the way that, you know, he was one of those guys that was very good at playing with one kick drum and basically making that one kick drum and that one pedals do double bass drum patterns. And then there's the Bonham shuffle and all that. But, you know, I always kept saying that there's nothing worse than the sound of a struggling drummer. Oh, that's terrible. You know, it's terrible. It's just that, like, the most unmusical sound. There's no instrument that sounds more pitiful than the drums when someone is just not on top of it.
You can't have a good metal band with a terrible drummer. That's just not a thing. It's not a thing. It's never been done.
It's never been done. And I think that on the other end of the scale, one of the most beautiful things is just have a drummer make it sound so effortless and so easy. And that was one of the strengths of Bonham. You know, it wasn't just this creativity and technique and feel, but it's just like it's so effortless. A Bonham would have to be there with Jim Morrison, and then what is just one of the, to me, one of the greatest musicians of all time, because of how I define a musician's strength, is Tony Iommi, because there are some very conventional ways of defining the strength of someone's musicianship, and it's usually through their technique and the greater and the more complex his or her technique, the better. But to me, that sort of rules out creativity. And there's something to be said for being the guy who invented the heavy metal riff, you know. Yes. Not many have that on their CV. And he
does.
Yeah, he did. You know, he was the guy that invented the heavy metal riff. And not only did he do that, but incredible melodic sense. A real distinct sound, which I think is a quality that is very often talked about outside of metal, but not enough in metal, is that the fact that one thing that defines a good musician is how you recognize them. And I think that there are so many guitar players that have learned how to play Tony Iommi style, like with his vibrato and with his bends. And then, you know, you think to yourself that that sounds very much like Iommi, but I've seen them live on a few occasions. And I think to myself when I hear him play, it's like, yeah, anyone can play what he's playing, but when he's playing it, it's just completely different. So
I gotta say, Into the Void forever. Into the Void's one of the greatest riffs of all time.
Into the Void, yeah. I don't know if I have any favorite song, but I think that maybe it would have to be if anyone, I'm not very sentimental, but maybe in this case I am. I think the two of the first songs that I really remember was the song Black Sabbath and Iron Man. His melodic sense on a National Acrobat, for example, you know. So yeah.
Okay, so we're two in.
So these were the three really obvious ones, but probably there are many candidates for the last one, but I think there's something very special about what Quorthon did, because Bathory was as revolutionary as Norwegian black metal was. I think that he downplayed his own role. He kept talking about how it was just Motorhead on amphetamine, but it wasn't. It was a lot more than that. And the guy with his guitar playing and with his singing and with his composition and with his lyrics, he didn't just write a new chapter in the book of metal, but a completely new book. Maybe not all of it was. I would say that if you look at the first record, some of it is a bit loose, you have some fantastic vocal performances and some amazing riffs that really created a new dawn. The return, I'm not so sure about the sonics, but the infernal darkness of that record, wow. But then perhaps the most defining work of them all, both in terms of his writing, his creativity, his pioneering qualities and his innovation, his feeling, his guitar playing, everything was under the sign of the Black Mark. And given what Quorthon has meant for black metal, which is what I have, you know, closest to my heart, he has to go up there on Mount Rushmore with these other legends.
That's important. Okay, we have one final question, which is five songs that change your life.
Yeah, so we talked about some of them. We talked about the
song. We may have already covered this. Yeah.
The song Black Sabbath. I think that talking about Bathory. Well, maybe more so than anything on Under the Sign of the Black Mark. I think A Fine Day to Die on Blood Fire Death. Slayer, Angel of Death. Celtic Frost, Circle of the Tyrants. And Massive Attack, Rising Sun.
Yeah, that's cool. Mm. Why?
Because I was always open and receptive to quality music, but metal was my thing. But I was very curious. I wanted to explore other types of great music. As I got older, I knew it was out there, but I just needed to be exposed to it. So I would ask people from that I knew were very dedicated to the art of being a music lover, but not being metal, and I would ask them for recommendations. And back in the days where you could talk to your record store owner about things and discuss music, so I would discover things that way. But it wasn't. It was a vast landscape to navigate through, and still is in many ways. But Massive Attack with their early records, I felt like, okay, well, it's interesting. Some of this I like, and this would be an example of some type of music that is not metal, but it has certain qualities that I like. But I felt that, yeah, there's something there, but it's not fantastic.
Yeah, it's just something.
Yeah, and then I remember living out on the countryside, an hour north of the city, in the late 90s for 3.5 years or whatever it was, and then there was a radio show at the time which was two and a half hours long, which was very much like a music lover radio show. So
cool.
I would sometimes, when driving home from the city out to my place, listen to that show now and then. And then there was this, just this introduction when I turned on about, yeah, so Massive Attack has a new record coming out, and it's coming out in 2 weeks and blah, blah, and we're going to play you a couple of songs. And, you know, here I am sitting in the car thinking, oh yeah, I know those guys. They got a few songs which are interesting. And then I listened to it and I thought, oh wow, what happened here? You know, what happened here? And that was a defining moment, because then I, on a deeper level, understood that there is greatness in other types of music, which is as profound as the greatness of metal music at its very best. It's out there, but I have to keep looking for it because it's there. And that was a validation of this hope that there's something out there as great as what I normally listen to.
Yeah.
But I just don't know where it is. And here's this band that I'm somewhat familiar with, which I think is somewhat good, but not great as in what I really consider to be great.
That
was a defining moment.
Okay, one more question, because you're talking about like just the whole concept of metal, black metal being closest to your heart. I mean, you've had a 30-year relationship. How has that relationship changed from when you started it?
I think one of the most important things about black metal, outside being what it's given, that I find the music to be great, that it felt incredibly renewing and fresh And I think if people think about it, when they were first introduced to it, certainly most people will agree that, yes, giving it some thought, that is indeed one of the effects, because people were listening to this and they said, like, the production, the sonics was very different from thrash metal and black metal and all these other things, and more emphasis on atmosphere and less on the technical side of the performance. More repetitive, philosophical, and less down to earth, more of a larger than life quality, more the visuals, more atmospheric, more mysterious, and more artistic, I would say.
Yeah.
And then as time went by, it loses its quality of surprise and being new and fresh and all that. So then it's just the music and the sonics and the artistry, which is great. But indeed, some of it also was, in many ways, like, even if I wasn't a part of that, I can only imagine that punk rock was like that.
Totally.
Yeah, that punk rock had that, oh, what the hell is going on here, you know? Really? Yeah. But when it doesn't have that effect anymore, I don't think you can recreate the day one effect, but you have to at least be respectful and considerate of the fact that that was one of the things that made it great to people. And in order for it to not stand still and become a formula and recipe driven type of music, you have to, as an artist, try and be proactive in how you not just push forward musically, but also how you challenge people's perception of what black metal is.
Yes.
I think Satyricon has been a band that has tried to do that. And interestingly enough, I find that really what it comes down to is that our critics, their main argument towards the band is the fact that we've changed and that we don't fulfill their expectations of what Satyricon should be. So they're saying, stop doing this because I have an idea of what Satyricon is. And now what you're doing is that you're messing with my idea. And I like to stay in this little bubble and think of Satyricon a particular way. And what you're doing to me is that you burst the bubble, you're ruining everything.
Yeah.
Call your music something else, change the name of your band.
Yeah. People said that to you.
So when I see that, I think to myself, okay, good. Then it really works, doesn't it? Because what we're doing is that, first and foremost, we set out to make great music. That is our goal. We're not out there to offend people. We're out there to try and make great music. But also part of our motivation is to be conscious and aware of the fact that black metal has been around for 30 years now. And if black metal is going to have an effect on the next generation of black metal fans, we can't spend time trying to satisfy old conservative farts. We have to look at the next generation who will replace them when they go on the 70,000 tons of metal cruise, which they eventually will, you know. I talked to a guy which is, I don't know, he's maybe 61, 62, And up here we have a festival in my neighborhood called Tons of Rock, big Norwegian metal festival. I think it's run by Live Nation. Mm-hmm. And this acquaintance of mine, he said that, yeah, I walked by and I thought he was going to say that, oh, too much noise or whatever. But I said, yeah, so what about it? You didn't know that we have a metal festival in our neighborhood? And said, no, I'm well aware of that. So I said, so what's the story? And he said, well, that was a bunch of old people, that's for sure. And I said, yeah. He said, yeah, people my age. And I said, yeah, how old are you? And he said, you know, I'm a grown-up guy. And I'm not exactly sure how old he is, but probably 60, 61, 62. Yeah. So that's funny, huh? Because metal people, they don't realize that they're getting old too.
Yeah, we need to replace. You need to replace.
Yeah. Yeah, so there has to be new blood in terms of fans, new blood in terms of bands, new blood in terms of press, new blood everywhere. And as I said, the most important thing is to try and make good music, but it is also to show fans, other artists, new generations that... let's not think about this as a limited universe. Let's think about it as what black metal really is. It is defined by a feeling, and other than that, it is limitless.
Yes, an expanding universe, which is what we exist in, right? It's
exactly.
True.
Exactly.
Well, thank you very much.